Dear Sergei Викторович, dear friends, dear colleagues, modern world is a world of knowledge, and modern economy is economy of knowledge, and our university is a possibility to acquire knowledge in different fields, from economy to internal and foreign policy, and here we see the members of the university from the State Duma, from the Federation Council, from our from Молодая Гвардия, from Central Committee of our party, and in interactive regime we have 85 regional into 85 regions of our party, and heads of our fractions in regions. And of course, we are very grateful to the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of our country for the possibility to have this lecture here in the ministry. Right now, the problems of foreign policy are, of course, on the cutting edge of our internal policy and our foreign policy. We have unprecedented difficult relations with Western countries. We have very high pressure, informational pressure on our country. And of course, there are certain efforts of Russian Federation to strengthen its strategic positions in non-Western directions. And of course, a very interesting moment for today's lecture was a set of very interesting events that would be a Commonwealth of Independent States Summit in Minsk, the meeting of our Minister Sergei Lavrov with John Kerry, that would be the visit of Li Keqiang to Moscow, that would be the a meeting of our President Vladimir Putin in Belgrade, and then a SEM summit in Milan, where he met the leaders of Western and Eastern countries, and of course the president of Ukrainian state, Petro Poroshenko. So the matter is very difficult and very important, and our lecturer of our university, the Minister of Foreign Affairs, Sergei Lavrov, maybe we could greet him with applause. Dear Alexander Alexeyevich, dear friends, thank you for the invitation. I responded to that with pleasure, since in our interest to discuss with the representatives of different political powers and, of course, our leading party, the problems that emerge and that have been mentioned, they directly affect the lives of Russian citizens, the plans of our development, they directly influence the way the situation evolves in the world and the world order. This situation is defined by the transition, and apparently we are dealing not with a new age, but with a transition of eons. That such critical moments are turbulent, unstable, and unpredictable in international processes, and we see that in regions and in global development. One of the most critical events of our time is the redistribution of global balance of powers. It is showed by the economic power, followed by political influence of the countries of Asian Pacific region. They have been acting as a locomotion of economic growth that used to be the role of United States, Western Europe, and Japan. China has been the most successful in that, and according to the latest report of the IMF, has been the first in purchasing power parity for the first time. By the way, according to the experts of IMF, that seven emerging countries, including Russia, have surpassed in aggregate GDP the seven industrially developed countries. So there is a new world order that does not fit in the notion of Western domination in world economy, finance, and politics. The catalyst of those changes was the financial crisis that has ended the speculations about the victory of a liberal capitalist model and the necessity for all to adjust to it. You remember in the late 90s there was a so-called end of history, but it didn't take place. It's evident that now we have competition not only in economy and in finance, but also the competition of values and models of development. It has highlighted the downsides of laissez-faire economy that, after the Cold War, freed from any government control, has generated vast crisis events. Right now, I can draw an example. The director of IMF, Christine Lagarde, talks about the need to divorce from the distorted view where revenue prevails over prudence, pursuing egoistic interests prevails over common cause, and excesses destroy ethics. That's the words of the director of the IMF. The forming of the new world is also connected with other events that make the picture of the world more complex than earlier. We have such transborder challenges as the VMD proliferation, terrorism, drug trafficking, resources and food deficiency, mass epidemics, and so on and so forth. The processes of globalization have increased the transparency of national borders and have led to destruction of closed societies, which what was the way of life of most of the part of humanity. So they tried to conserve their cultural, religious, and civilization identity. If their right was not recognized, it led to what Samuel Huntington called the clash of civilization. The international situation has been aggravating due to conflict zones that would not only be interstate conflicts, but intrastate crises, including ethnic and sectarian grounds. That is shown in Middle East and North Africa, and there is a danger of uniting those crises in one explosive knots. The massive destabilization of the region that we witness has been influencing in the negative way the international situation. That leads to growing chaos and anarchy in international affairs, compromises the efficiency of a system of global governments that is not at its best right now. The extent of challenges the international community faces right now calls for united efforts and taking effective steps to ensure international security and stability. And unfortunately, it has collided with the will of our colleagues from the United States to assume the approach of superiority and domination. With undue euphoria after the end of bipolar world, the United States have tried to realize the concept of unipolar world where they would have the possibility to reformat the situation on all regions, any state, according to their own views. That has put the key principles of the UN Charter into question, that would be sovereignty, the territorial integrity of states, non-interference in the internal matters, and peaceful settlement of disputes. United States and their allies have tried to meddle under the slogan of protecting human rights and promoting democratic processes. For that, they have used different methods like sanctions or use of military force even. Without the resolution of the United Nations Security Council, or they have conducted military intervention in Yugoslavia, Iraq, and Libya. Lately, Washington has been stating that they have the right to use military force everywhere to defend their national interests. That is directly written in the Doctrine on Security that was adopted by the United States in 2010. If it says that if it requires, if the interests of the United States require that, Washington will act regardless of any international norms. They have defined the technology of destabilizing the situation in states and conducting color revolutions for regime change. In most cases, such interference does not only aggravate the suffering of civilians, but also fuels the armed struggle. We witness the use of double standards to realize the geopolitical projects. We are concerned with the breakaway from universal principles of combating terrorism. For example, some Western states have been supporting the extremist groups fighting against Muammar Gaddafi. After that, French army has had to fight those radicals in Mali, the very radicals they had been arming. Now, under the slogan of ending the regime of President Assad in Syria, the Western countries have been led extremists grow strong in that country. That has led to growing threat from ISIS or Islamic states that has captured territories in Iraq and Syria, and those territories are ruled according to Sharia law, and you could read that anywhere in papers or on the internet. The situation in Iraq, where American troops have been for more than 10 years, shows the absurdity of the artificial implanting of models of social and economic development. Today, this friendly country that Americans once tried to make an example of modernization for all the Arabic peoples is fighting against deepest political crisis that threatens its existence as a state. Russia is consistent in supporting the governments of Iraq and Syria in their struggle against religious extremists that have been trying to acquire power. And among our methods is sending arms and military equipment to their troops. We are for consolidating international efforts to counter terrorist threat. We do not take part in the so-called international coalition of the United States, since we believe that such efforts should be conducted under the auspices of the Security Council of the United Nations. Such principles are not consistent with the American practice of airstrikes in ISIS in Syrian territory without any accordance with the Syrian government. And that would also mean the support of so-called opposition that fights ISIS but also fights Bashar Assad. And they're trying to arm them so that they would grow strong to topple the regime. That would show the contradictions and paradox in the actions. We are trying to understand our American colleagues, but we have not been successful so far. So the situation in Middle East has been aggravating, and it's very complex, and we need to consider this as a complex, including Arab-Israel conflict, that now people try to look away from, but the situation that has been for almost 70 years or even more, we believe that's one of the main reasons that allows extremists to acquire new allies, including jihadists that would be ready for terrorist attacks, including suicide bombings. We believe that all that factors as a complex need to be considered under the auspices of the Security Council of the United Nations. And such initiative has growing interest in countries that take responsible stance for the situation in the region. I should note that for international forces of security in Afghanistan have also been unsatisfactory, although this operation was in general sanctioned by the Security Council after Al-Qaeda conducted an attack on the United States on the 11th of September 2001. Despite such mandate, the methods used have led to the situation now that the coalition is going to leave the Afghanistan until the end of the year. This country is far from a stable situation and faces different threats such as terrorism that has been there for a long time, the threat of drug trafficking that has increased during the presence of coalition forces there and has deteriorated the situation in our neighbors, including the ones in Central Asia. That means that the problems of the modern world, including region conflicts, can only be solved only based on complex approach that provides for active roles of all countries, including neighbors. We have drawn the attention of our partners to that fact when Iran was not invited to Geneva for inter-Syrian settlement, and to Paris, Iran and Syria were not invited, where we discussed combating ISIS. Yet, we try to understand, and we cannot understand, the position of our colleagues from NATO who refused to interact with CSTO. That would be a very efficient alliance because NATO would provide most of the power, and CSTO has been conducting operations to combat drug trafficking and combat terrorism. And over time, that would improve the efficiency of struggle for the stability in Afghanistan. Yet NATO, for no apparent reason, has been refusing that suggestion, and that doesn't help at all. Despite those critical changes in the world, the states of the Western states still try to hold on to their dominant position in international affairs. Such approach has been a negative influence in Europe. After the destruction of Berlin Wall, our Western partners have missed the historical chance, ignoring our suggestions to create unified structure of security in our territories. We believe that such task was very doable, taking into account the present mechanisms in OSCE. Instead, NATO has been in several surges, expanding towards the east and approaching its infrastructure to our borders. And as ex-ambassador of the United States to the USSR, Jack Matlock, said, the participants of negotiations about the end of Cold War understood that if they created such new barriers, that would create new problems. And Russia later was being convinced that such course was not a threat to its security. And our partners took offense when we said that was not the case. The political declarations about the need to create a unified security structure was accepted on the OSCE level and the Council Russia-NATO, but now we don't see that. And lately we have heard the statement that must be a mistake, that only NATO has the power to give legally binding guarantees of security. Right now we hear different statements and the fact, and you have lately heard Chuck Hagel say that Russian army is now on NATO's doorstep. This was discussed in our media quite efficiently. I'm not going to elaborate on that. Of course, you know that our leadership will try to take all necessary measures to ensure the security of our country. As for our United States colleagues, they show themselves the ones who aggravate the situation and security in Europe.
Well, and speaking about Eastern Partnership, it was also aimed at expanding to the east the area which is under Western control. And probably the main purpose, the mission of this Eastern Partnership project was the one that I have mentioned. And that is why the projects that could involve Russia in trilateral projects have never been implemented. That is probably why the EU tried to make the CIS countries face a very tough choice. They had to choose whether they wanted to be with the European Union or with Russia. They employed the same approach to Ukraine. And that is why this country, which is only beginning to create a sustainable security infrastructure, they pushed it to this severe crisis, political crisis the country is facing at the moment. This trend did not only occur last year. Before the association agreement was supposed to be signed, 10 years ago, when Mr. Yanukovych was the rival of Mr. Yushchenko, the European Union, through the Constitutional Court, imposed an anti-constitutional decision to carry out a third tour of elections that had not yet been enshrined in the Constitution back then. And the European politicians, the back then Foreign Minister, Belgian Foreign Minister Karel de Gucht, who is at the moment ending his career as Euro Commissioner for Trade, back then he said publicly that Ukraine had to make a choice whether it wanted to be together with the European Union or with Russia. This is not something new. This is what was the foundation of the European approach to their foreign policy. And speaking about why the anti-government rally started, why the decision of Mr. Yanukovych to delay signing of the association agreement was the pretext for starting those rallies is also an evidence of the fact that this decision was in line with what the European pro-European administration in Kyiv has done now. They actually have done the same as we had asked them to do. They decided to postpone the implementation of the economic provision of the association agreement to January 2016. That is a very reasonable step. No one would doubt that. They agreed that linking Ukraine's obligations to Russia with its obligations to the European Union, on the other hand, is something realistic. They agreed that it was necessary for Ukraine's economy. But the thing is that they have only come to this decision a year later. They could have done that back then, back when we suggested to start consultations between Russia, Ukraine and the European Union. We've had to pay thousands of lives for their decision. The infrastructure has been destroyed and civil war was on the way. Support on behalf of the United States and the European Union of the anti-constitutional coup d'etat that happened in Kyiv. And the fact that they tried to force the Ukrainian citizens to denounce on their lifestyle, on their native language, and other things that they absolutely have a right to use, is a clear violation of the founding documents of the OSCE. And the actions of the ultranationalist, extremely right forces that came to power in Kyiv were the root cause of the rallies on Maidan. They wanted to establish their order in Odessa and Mariupol. They trampled upon the agreement of February 21st. And of course, the overwhelming majority of the Crimean people wanted to counter that actions. That is why they expressed their free will to rejoin Russia in the plebiscite. They did it according to their self-determination right, which is enshrined in the Charter of the United Nations. And we found mass cemeteries near Donetsk. And that is why we know for sure what the destiny of the Crimean people could have been. And speaking about the accident of the Malaysian Boeing that crashed over the Ukraine, this situation definitely has to be investigated. We have to carry out a just and unbiased investigation. At the moment, some political players are making efforts in order to postpone the investigation or not to allow it to be carried out at all. Every time we meet our European partners, we ask them why they do not want to carry out that investigation, because we have to make sure that the human rights are protected. And the President of the Russian Federation has repeatedly emphasized that what is going on in the Ukraine is our common tragedy, and we have to do all we can in order to put an end to it. On April 17th in Geneva, we agreed on principles that could open a way to peaceful resolution on the conflict, based, as it is stated in our declaration, on the immediate start of the all-nation dialogue, based on respect of all regions and the interests of all political forces of the country. This has not been done. We've wasted a lot of time, but now, after we've signed Minsk agreements, the prospect of the political settlement is open again. And as you probably know, during the Milan meetings, our president reiterated again our support to full implementation of the Minsk agreements. And he called upon every party that had concluded the Minsk agreements to do so with the support of Russia and the OSCE. It is also related to the speed process of separation of opponents, withdrawal of heavy weapons, organizing OSCE monitoring missions, as well as the preparation of the elections at the southeast of the country. The negotiations in Milano have proved that It is very important to forestall any attempts to distort the agreements that the militia and the government representatives have came to in Minsk. If somebody wants to prevent Russia from doing what it believes is right by implying threats and pressure, are absolutely unrealistic, because these threats is not something that could ensure the respect for human rights in the Ukraine. All those attempts taken with the support of the United States and orchestrated by the United States are actually contrary to the interests of the European Union, as Russia is one of the leading trade and economic partners for them. All those sanctions are to the detriment of both Russia and the European countries. We've drawn our European partners' attention to decreasing the growth rates of the biggest European economy, Germany, and the fact that the last series of sanctions was adopted by the European Union when the ceasefire agreement had been concluded only proves that the situation is used by Washington in its attempts to impose its so-called leadership in all the Atlantic space, to make the European Union take the approach that is not even supported by some of the EU countries. It is another manifestation of the fact that the United States is not going to stop its efforts, no matter what Russia does, because the most important goal is to use Ukraine as an irritating factor in the relations between Russia and the European Union. They just want to show Russia its place. Let me emphasize one more time that all these attempts are futile. They are unrealistic and fallacious, and probably sensible politicians already starting to realize that. Speaking about the relations between Russia and the United States, they are less significant in economy than the relations between Russia and EU, but still a lot depends on our efficient cooperation in addressing international issues. And the United States absolutely have to realize that successful resolution of political issues on the international agenda depends on their cooperation with Russia. And in order to ensure their national interests, they still have to find common ways with us. They are aware of that, but what they're trying to do at the moment, they try to use a two-pronged policy. They, on the one hand, they want to impose sanctions against us, and on the other hand, they want to cooperate with us, whether they need that. And last week, I had a meeting with Mr. Kerry, the State Secretary of the United States, and I explained to him that they cannot take a selective approach. We have to cooperate honestly, openly, on an equal basis, based on the respect for equal rights of every country, and based on the respect to intellectual potential of the partners. Because you know what our American partners sometimes do. They come with a solution of a certain problem in Iraq, Afghanistan, or in Yemen, and then they say that the decision has already been taken in Washington, and they just call upon other parties to provide for the international cooperation based on the decision taken in Washington. Our vision of ways to address the international problems is a little different from how they see it in Washington. You know, theory is always verified by practice, and the practice shows that wherever Americans interfere, chaos starts to rule. We are absolutely convinced that we have to take joint efforts from the very beginning. We have to assess the situation together, and then we have to work together on possible solutions for various problems. This is the only approach that can lead us to good results. We are sure that unleashing confrontation in Euro-Atlantic region is a dead end. It is absolutely a non-starter, and any attempts to resolve the issues in the continent without Russia is doomed to failure. every time the European countries try to address the international issues without Russia, they failed. And creating new dividing lines in the common world and creating new visa and economic hindrances is definitely obsolete. Let me quote Mr. Dostoevsky, who said, "The words sound like they were said yesterday. In Europe, they shout about the Russian conquerors and cunning Russians, but I suppose that those who shout about it do not believe it themselves." And you know, it is very similar to what we hear at the moment. Each of our European partners emphasizes that they believe it is necessary to take into account our legitimate interests. They know how we saved Europe from Napoleon's attempts to conquer the whole continent. They also remember how in 20th century we saved Europe from similar Hitler's ambitions, from the dictator who wanted to command all the Europeans. They reiterate that again and again that they remember all that Russia has done for them. But at the same time, they're referring to their European solidarity. And that is why when all the European countries are together, these sensible voices and opinions are never heard. Probably there are European countries who express reasonable opinions behind closed doors, but when they speak publicly, what we hear is their stubborn anti-Russian position that is probably imposed by anti-Russian politicians within the European Union. It is a very sad thing, and it is absolutely anti-democratic. We believe that every country in the OSCE and in any other organizations should have the courage and the right to hear its voice heard. Several countries of the European Union, not the biggest European Union countries, but still, that they've been courageous enough to express their opinion. Others have tried to punish them for that, but I believe that those reasonable voices will be heard, there will be more of them, and they will sound all the more louder.
We believe that there is no viable alternative to cooperation between us and the European Union, as well as between us and the United States. But we need our partners to realize that, and they should understand how counterproductive is this situation and the need for equal rights dialogue. We are still all for strategic cooperation between us and the European Union in united economic and humanitarian space with a united security structure in which no one will strengthen his own structure at the expense of the others. On the 1st of January, we start new step in our dialogue with the European Union between us and the EEU. As for convergence of integrations, earlier European Union wouldn't even like to hear about such notions, but right now they're talking about the need to establish cooperation with our Eurasian project. It's a grand project, it provides basis for our cooperation in CIS space in the long term. You already know that in the next year Armenia will be the next member of our customs union, and we continue our work with a roadmap with Kyrgyzstan. I'm sure that our other neighbors will be interested as well. We believe that the creation of the EEU is not only input in increasing the efficiency and competitiveness of our partners' economies, but also to improve international trade and providing stable development of our regions. We believe that we have all the capacity to become a link between integrational structure of Europe and Asian Pacific region. Lately, we have done a lot to develop our partnership with the states of Asian Pacific regions. In that light, a lot of people say that under the influence of the sanctions by the United States and the European Union, Russia is changing its direction in international relations from west to east. The reality is that we have been long prioritizing the cooperation with our Asian Pacific partners. And that line, the line to develop our connections, our cooperation with Asian Pacific regions, with their integrational structures in that region, that will be implemented in any changes on any other direction. Of course, the situation with the sanctions is just another impulse. But we would like to do that not instead, but side by side with our cooperation with Western countries. We have been very successful in developing our strategic partnership with China. As you already know, lately in Moscow there was a great deal of documents was signed between Russia and China. That was important not only in strengthening the relations between our countries, but also in promoting our economies, in solving our social and humanitarian problems. But that would also be very important in strengthening the stability in international relations. We believe that those relations are a fact of international life, and it has been very prominent, and we are very active in cooperating with China in BRICS, in Shanghai Organization of Security, and other formats. We are all for network diplomacy, all for creating flexible coalition of states according to their common interests. We take active stance in the G20, in the summit in 2013. And of course, the results of the BRICS summit in Fortaleza in Brazil have shown that BRICS is an attractive structure and has more and more allies, including the G20, including such countries as Indonesia, Mexico, Argentina, Egypt, Saudi Arabia. We insist on implementing the decisions that were made 4 years ago about another reform of international monetary system, including including the quotas and votes of BRICS countries in managing the IMF. And right now, we cannot promote them because of the unwillingness of the US Congress to cooperate. But we will still find a way to implement our intentions despite the ruses of our American colleagues. Our doctrine is all for security of our country, its stable position in international situation, and we believe that the system of international relations should be developing in multipolar aspect, both in economy and finance and world politics. We are ready to improve our cooperation with any states, any organization that would be interesting, of course, on the principle of equality and mutual interests. Our approach to international stability and just democratic international system that would represent the geographical and organizational difference in the world is shared by most states. And that has lately shown in the growth of our cooperation with our partners in Latin America and Africa and others. We will still be conducting our independent policy in international politics according to our national interests and our willingness to create a governable international system. I will quote our president. I count on the situation, says Vladimir Putin, that not only our historical memory, but the historical memory of all the humanity will lead us to seek for peaceful settlement of all conflicts that would happen and will happen in the future. We are all for political dialogue and compromise. And I will reiterate, we are ready to conduct dialogue with respect on the principles of equality. Thank you very much. I'm ready for your questions. Thank you very much, Sergei Viktorovich, for very accurate and complex description of the international situation. We have time to answer your questions. Please, I'll be the first to ask. Sergei Viktorovich, according to your latest negotiations with American colleagues, how would you characterize our relations? What's the dynamics? Is it going up or down? Is it stabilized at its lowest point? And did you discuss sanctions while meeting with John Kerry? It's always a temptation to find a certain image because people have been talking about the return of the Cold War. Of course, that's not Cold War. You may remember that at the previous stage of our relations, maybe in the late Bush administration, the political analysts tried to invent the term cool world as opposed to Cold War. I believe that we'll leave that to historians who will try to characterize this period for books. The right question is where they are and where they are headed. Of course, the situation in our relations has deteriorated a lot, and I believe that we have reached something like rock bottom, and right now we have no great falls, but there are no efforts to improve the relations. Of course, we conduct negotiations and we meet with John Kerry, and that's a regular meeting of ministers of foreign affairs with John Kerry. To my opinion, that's explained in most cases that was the initiative of our American colleagues. I believe that means that our colleagues in the State Department understand that the situation is not normal. Well, when we put to risk a lot important not only for Russia and the United States, but for the whole humanity aspects of our cooperation. The example is the presidential commission that was created to prepare for suggestions about certain projects of for more than 20 fields, from disarmament, combating terrorism, non-proliferation of WMD, and humanitarian aspect, and dialogue of civil societies, and of course agriculture, medicine, space, nuclear energy. There have been more than 20 work groups on the level of heads of departments. We discussed that and prepared reports, and they were sent to both presidents. But that structure was ended by the United States. What suffers? Of course, certain programs, certain matters that require solving. Not only for Moscow and Washington, but for most other countries, like combating illnesses and epidemics, such suggestions to use the possibilities to meet on the level of ministers of foreign affairs shows that there is understanding, that there is need to improve the situation. How that understanding fares in the State Department itself and beyond about the fact that we need dialogue on the principle of equality, I don't know. At our latest meeting with John Kerry, we have reiterated that the interaction of our countries in international affairs influences the world a lot, and we'll try to continue our interaction. And Russia does not mean to take the to take offense or shoot its own leg or do something to that would harm its own interests. But we have stated very clearly, as I have said in the main part of my lecture, for example, combating international terrorism. We have been invited to the coalition, but we have explained to John Kerry that they have had a revelation only now, when they understood that ISIS is a threat. But when ISIS emerged from Al-Qaeda and started growing strong in itself, they did not recognize that threat because they wanted to use that organization as a means to combat Assad regime. Right now, we understand that those people do not want to create democracy in Syria, but they want to create a caliphate in all that great region. And they have a goal to take power in governing the Islamic world. That's evident and that's declared. And if extremists take the leading roles in Islam, and of course Muslims themselves will suffer the first, since their primary enemy is moderate Islam that does not provide for armed struggle. And we cannot pretend that only now this has become evident, because we have been supporting, and we are now supporting Syria and Iraq and other countries, strengthening their capabilities in combating terrorists and extremists, despite what our American partners did, because we are creating a coalition. Let's create that coalition. Let's make a decision in the Security Council. That would make combating, but right now we see combating terrorism as a means to punish certain regimes. That's not right, and that's immoral in a way. That would only lead to accumulation of chaos and anarchy. That would lead to creating new threats to the region itself and the countries that interact with that region, including Russia, Central Asia, and Europe.
That is what I wanted to say regarding counteracting terrorism. If we do want to counteract terrorism, let us do it in an honest and open way, based on equal rights. Let us coordinate our common strategy. And I suppose the UN has all the necessary mechanisms for that. When the practical steps taken to combat terrorism are taken beyond the United Nations, it makes us think that they were invented beyond the United Nations. Otherwise, the American partners would have asked the approval of the United Nations. They would like their steps to be adopted. And our American partners, Mr. Kerry proved that during our meeting in Paris, they've repeatedly suggested that we should restart and renew the process of negotiating the reduction of our nuclear arsenals and to continue the process. I explained to my colleague that the issues related to strategic stability and security could only be tackled as a whole set of issues. At the moment, we are speaking about the Strategic Arms Reduction Treaty as of 2010. It is a very important step in this area, and it is the step that has to be implemented before we realize what else we can do to enhance our strategic stability. Under any circumstances, these issues have to be tackled as a complex, as a set of issues. It has to include the anti-missile defense. We also have to tackle the problem that is related to the instant nuclear strike. It is a program elaborated by the US. It is based on hypersound armaments that are not going to be equipped with nuclear devices, but they are so accurate and so fast that, based on their military characteristics, they are going to be much more effective than nuclear weapons. If they do use such weapons, there will be no Hiroshima or no Nagasaki, but these armaments can be used much more efficiently to achieve political goals. The problem related to the plans of the United States to take their weapons to the outer space is also a problem. The US is the only country that is opposed to developing a treaty that could ban taking weapons to the outer space. All the rest of the countries are ready to start work. And there's also a very important issue related to the disbalance of the strategic weapons. All the issues in their complexity have been agreed and chosen for further consideration under one of the working groups of the Presidential Commission. But now our American partners have frozen the process within this working group. And now they pretend that nothing has happened. They pretend that they're ready to start conversation on further reduction of nuclear weapons. But, you know, the way they behave, they act towards us. They do it like we are naive and we could let them continue this way. And speaking about the medium and long range missiles, there was an address to Mr. Putin where they stated that we allegedly made a violation of the treaty. Then we suggested that we carry out consultations. When we conducted consultations, they promised that they would be able to present certain facts that would prove that we had violated the treaty. And speaking about our concerns related to possible violations on behalf of the Americans have not been answered. And, you know, there immediately was a leakage about Obama writing a concerned message to Mr. Putin. Why they did it, I don't know. But what I know is that our American partners have to be constrained, probably not within the international law, but at least by the diplomatic decency. This is a difficult thing to do. I'm not complaining at the moment. It is an objective trend. Their psychology and their mentality mean that the Congress is applauding, or the whole square in one of the countries, Alice, is applauding. This decision is taken unilaterally, and then it is presented to the whole world as an ultimate one. We are probably going to reach a different stage in this process, but the time has to pass. Even now, the Americans are starting to realize that they will not be able to achieve any goals alone. And they're starting to realize that when they work in a coalition, but take the actions that they have developed unilaterally, all these efforts are doomed to failure. And the examples of Iraq and Afghanistan have already shown that. The period of downturn in our relations is probably going to last for quite a long period of time. What we have to do now is to think about what we can do together. We should not be thinking about taking any unilateral measures. What also matters is that the reassessment of the U.S. place in the world and the problem of Americans reassessing what has happened during the last decade, as well as their awareness of the fact that there is no alternative at the moment. The world is becoming more and more multipolar. There are new emerging centers of economic and political power. But all these processes will definitely have time. Still, they are underway. We can see that these processes are underway in G20, in BRICS, within Shanghai Cooperation Organizations. These processes are also underway in Latin America, where for the first time in history there has been created an association of the Latin countries and Caribbean countries. It is an association that the United States is not a member to. This is an unprecedented fact. This is the first association that was created by the Latin America countries. And the similar associations are trying to feel more independent in the world arena. They've created their own independence committee, and they've created their own military forces. The African Union mechanisms are also starting to get more efficient. I've taken too long to answer your question, but the question was, in fact, a complicated one. So what I was trying to say is that the process is going to take a long time, but there is no alternative to it. What we have to do now is to explain to everyone that measures taken to go back to the Cold Era are doomed to failure. I think that every country, including the big countries of Latin America and other regions, have to say that to the United States, probably not in public, probably behind closed doors, but that is what we have to do to expedite the process. Thank you.
I'd ask the colleagues to introduce themselves and please a comment to our technicians. We have questions from the regions, from the Crimea and from Ingushetia Republic. Bobolin Daltonch, State Duma Deputy, Member of Parliament. Distinguished Sergei, Mr. Lavrov, I'd like to ask you about our neighbors in the southeast. Not long ago, we've had the Caspian Summit, and I'd like to hear from you. What is your assessment? What was on the agenda and what decisions have been made, and whether it will change the alignment of forces in the international arena? kind of continuation to my previous question as a follow-up. I finished by enumerating the trends in favor of strengthening of regional cooperation in various parts of the world, and the Caspian region is one of the areas that has been a magnet for everybody because it's of strategic importance and geography-wise and transit-wise and energy resources-wise, it's very important. And the Astrakhan summit of the Caspian Permanent Five was that a very important declaration was adopted. It was approved by five presidents, and the instrument enshrines the basic principles for defining the legal status of the Caspian Sea. These principles will underlie a convention on the legal status to be signed at next summit. The declaration will be used to fill the convention with specific provisions and articles, and the main principles approved by the leaders is that the five Caspian countries will decide all the areas of cooperation in the region. That refers to security at Caspian Sea. There will be no third country's armed forces. There will be no non-Caspian ships at sea, and the Caspian states have approved the width of national zones, of national areas, including sovereignty limits and fishing areas, which is one of the key issues that is to be reflected in the convention. And the work will be expedited a lot after this declaration. We have a couple issues pending yet, including those related to the Trans-Caspian pipelines construction. We believe that once there is an accord that the five states decide on their own without any external interference, we believe that these five countries are to decide the terms of laying down these pipelines across the Caspian Sea to provide for environmental safety. We have a Caspian Environmental Safety Convention in place and an instrument on preserving the biodiversity. That ecosystem is quite fragile and it must be protected. Therefore, we believe an accord is needed with the participation of all the Caspian states. I'm saying all this because the issue of laying down pipelines has seen some imposing of external solutions, and the main sponsors of these solutions are European officials. The European Commission believes they have their own political goals there. We don't think it's quite right, and we will uphold our view. Please connect Ingushetia. A question from the Ingushetia Regional Office of United Russia Party. Mr. Lavrov, we have recently been witnessing... Oh, I'm sorry. Amriva Marian Sultan, head of United Russia faction of the National People's Assembly of Ingushetia. Recently, we have been witnessing overt hatred of some of the Ukrainian people towards other Ukrainian people. I'm referring to manifestations and raids by Ukrainian nationalists with the slogans of xenophobia and hatred. And no one prevents them from that, I have the impression. Please answer, because in the framework of international law, is there any possibility of bringing them to account? Are there any entities that are to respond to such manifestations? It seems that Europe clean forgot about the results of the Second World War. And wouldn't it be kind of method to step up anti-fascist community to help them step up their activities, and something should be done about this. I fully concur with you. I believe that things that are happening now in Ukraine are dangerous. It's done with the connivance of the official authorities, and these young guys are marching across the streets with Nazi slogans, and they have been promoting the ideology that was rendered criminal by the Nuremberg trial, and like the attempts to declare the 14th of October the day of and defender of the motherland is of concern, because that was the day of creation of the Ukrainian guerrilla army. We've been trying to draw the attention of the Council of Europe, UN, and the OSCE to that fact. All these entities, international organizations, have been established after the fascism was defeated in the Second World War. The UN has it enshrined in its charter that its main task is to preclude a new tragedy similar in scale to World War II from happening. And you know that we have been making public various materials. We have a white book with all these facts included, and we have been in contact with intergovernmental organizations and non-governmental ones. Many of them in Europe conduct their own activities, conduct their own manifestations. We have been in contact with the Jewish Congress and other international entities. They express their concerns, but I believe, it's my profound belief, that they could do that in a louder voice and with more persuasion. And the Russian Jewish organizations should be playing a leading part in this. With respect to our further steps, I believe that apart from drawing everybody's attention that these manifestations and rallies are inadmissible, and we saw that the proponents of this ideology wanted to assert their ideology across the whole country, not only its western regions. And now in Kharkiv and Odessa, they took to the streets and faced no resistance. OSCE has launched Helsinki Plus 40 process that next year is to end with a new declaration to mark the 40th anniversary of the final act of Helsinki. Since then, lots of documents condemning xenophobic behaviors and racial discrimination practices have been denounced by this organization on many occasions. And the Foreign Affairs Ministers Council in the Swiss Basel will be held shortly. The Swiss are now presiding the international organization, and we would like to request all our partners to respond on what they think about all this, and we'll come up with a draft document that will reflect the attitudes of OSCE to the revival of Nazism in Ukraine and some other countries, although in other countries it's not so blatant or impertinent as what happens in Ukraine. And the attitudes of OSCE members will be the sure proof of whether they are loyal to the founding principles of the organization. And I'd like to mention the great role of the Federal Assembly of the Russian Federation with respect to fighting this scourge. And our MPs have been addressing international entities and parliamentary groups and assemblies and actively engaging at different platforms of the Council of Europe and the Parliamentary Assembly of the OSCE. The OSCE Parliamentary Assembly, as far as I know, regrets having made that decision, although they are trying to pretend they are doing the right thing. There are some channels and avenues that the Russian delegation in its current status can pursue. Okay. Mr. Lavrov, Mr. Vyacheslav, I would like to ask the question and seize the opportunity. I'm an attendee of the Diplomatic Academy, which is under the aegis of the Foreign Affairs Ministry. I haven't introduced myself. Arshinova Alena, Member of Parliament, State Duma Deputy. My question is as follows. I am not indifferent about Transnistria, and also Ukraine is of concern. It's an irritant, not only for the regional stakeholders, but Ukraine is, together with the Russian Federation, is one of the guarantors of the Transnistria settlement. But despite this fact, Ukraine not only never helped settle the breakaway republic conflict, but also facilitated the creation of two more breakaway republics on its own territory. Will the 2+2 format be changed regarding the status of Ukraine? What are the prospects of the conflict? And do you see any possible economic integration of the Transnistria and Moldova Republic into the customs union or Eurasian Economic Union? Thank you, Minister. Thank you. Status of Ukraine was defined in a collaborative format in the 5+2 arrangement. The two means Chișinău and Tiraspol, and five, Russia, Ukraine as the guarantors and brokers of the peace process, OSCE being a mediator, and the United States and the EU as observers. So the top status belongs to Russia and Ukraine. We are intermediaries and guarantors as well. That assumes special responsibility in following the founding principles and not trying to take sides. The Russian Federation, with special responsibility, treats its obligations. We never do anything that could be regarded as bias or being partial in favor of this or that party. On the contrary, our partners, including Ukrainians, try to revisit the basic principles of the Transnistrian settlement. To favor Moldova, including at the current stage when the Chișinău authorities are trying to move in a completely non-democratic direction. The Constitutional Court ruled that all parties that don't aim at integrating into the EU, joining the EU, are unconstitutional. I was stunned on reading the news, and now we're trying to investigate the details. If it's really true, it's astonishing. And the principles that we have been upholding are as follows. One should so you can find a special status for Transnistria with due respect for the territorial integrity of Moldova, that is to remain a sovereign and military and politically neutral state. Now they're trying to distort things and say that the political neutrality and military neutrality is a transient thing and their constitution may be changed. And with respect to sovereignty and their independence, we have a lot of questions, given not only Romania's statement by Romanian president that the reunion of Moldova and Romania is a matter of time. But as a matter of fact, we have seen similar remarks from leaders of Moldova. Out of 7 members of the Constitutional Court of Moldova, 6 are nationals of Romania, and these ruled in favor of that decision that any party that doesn't have the goal of acceding to the EU enshrined in its charter is unconstitutional. So, at the inception of 5+2 arrangement, everybody agreed back then that if Moldova would lose its sovereignty and be absorbed, or if the status would be changed from neutral into the bloc-based, the Transnistrian would have a full right to decide on their own upon their future. And this is the baseline argument that we will defend with respect to the economic development prospects for Transnistria and their cooperation with the Russian Federation Customs Union, Eurasian Economic Union that is now being fledged. We shall welcome these developments, and we hope that the Moldovan authorities will not place handicap on Transnistrians in their desire to forge ties. In their current status, they can't accede to the Eurasian Economic Union or Customs Union, but in line with the 1997 memorandum, Moldova has a right to pursue free external economic activities, which means free ties with all partners, including those that are members and parties to Customs Union or the EU. Now these ties are hindered. On the sidelines of the General Assembly, I met the Moldovan Minister of Foreign Affairs, and I conveyed our concerns to her. Similar signals is what we send to Ukrainians, similar messages. We want them to abide by the previously signed instruments and documents. And I hope that the Eurasian, that the European Union will realize the malign nature of the Ukrainian scenario. As a matter of fact, they have similar plans with respect to Moldova and Transnistria. The association agreement has been signed, and we had to change the MFN treatment to standard treatment for a number of items while trading with Moldova, which is not in line with our interests. Moldova is facing an election, and around 1 million of migrants from Moldova want to vote, and we are ready to organize all necessary arrangements so that the vote can take place in Russia, but so far we don't see any enthusiasm for the part of Chisinau. Probably they don't want these voices to be heard in favor of a more sober-minded position than just facing and heading west and burning the boats with the east. We'd like to involve the Americans as well, because they are monitors and observers. They have usurped the position of OSCE envoy on Transnistrian settlement. They have been inheriting this position and changing people on that position. And when the last renomination took place, we kind of tried to reverse the trend, because it's not right when a single country dominates the settlement process forever, but no other candidates turned up. And now they once again have an American as an envoy. He made a report to the Permanent Council of the OSC, and that is, well, to put it mildly, not quite objective a report, not quite impartial a report. Well, given the interest of the Americans, well, I met in March or in April with John Kerry, and I proposed it to him that we could make a joint statement that would spell out the vision of the Russian Federation and the United States on the immediate steps to restore and revive the Transnistrian settlement. And that was a short document of 1.5 pages, but we never received any response from them, any feedback from them. They keep being silent, which means that, well, they're probably not quite open for cooperation. And who is Mr. No and who is Mr. Yes?
Thank you, Mr. Alov. I think that wouldn't be right if we don't let one of our two most young regions speak. Crimea, please. Good afternoon, dear Mr. Lavrov. The people of Crimea are very enthusiastic about your actions. My name is Mr. Konstantinov. The question is, we have had a referendum, and you have mentioned it. We have used our constitutional right to referendum. That was a reaction of our people to the changes in Ukraine that were connected with coup. And you have also mentioned the actions of today's Ukrainian authorities that show the results of those actions. You have also mentioned the pro-fascist organizations. We started to combat that threat one of the first and try to avert this threat one of the first. The question is, what do you believe are the prospects of the international recognition of that referendum in Crimea that was held by the Crimean citizens when there was no legitimate authority in Ukraine, when the coup by, as we now understand, pro-fascist groups took place? What is the prospects of recognizing the status of Crimea? Well, that does not depend on us, as you understand. And we responded to the will of the Crimean citizens, first of all, because that was their free will, and the rights of the people who live in Crimea were threatened by extremists who took power in Kiev. I assure you, we didn't consider thoroughly the matter of recognition or not recognition of from the international community. We did what the Crimean people wanted, and that fact is evident to most sober-minded politics, politicians in Western countries and beyond. They have made statements that are not easy to take back, and right now they're following up their actions. Right in the countries in the European Union and NATO, they reiterate from one document to the other. They are talking about annexation. When you talk to them, when you give them facts, they do not use arguments. They just read out their documents as slogans. But we would like to engage them in a dialogue with the representatives of the Crimea, as we have done before, for you to tell them the truth of people who live on those in this territory, not the truth of the people who stay overseas. And we believe that it is right for our citizens that live in Crimea. They should have the right to tell their truth to the European and international community. You have had visitors from the European Union, and that was a great step for the truth to have its way. We'll do everything we can. Thank you very much. Mr. Lavrov agreed to stay with us for a little longer. I have a question. I believe a lot of us have that question, and it wouldn't be right if we omitted it. But we still on the Russian-Ukrainian negotiations that took place in Milan. Our president, in very general terms, organized the arrangements in gas sphere and about Minsk memorandum. But right after that, Kiev stated how they are going to implement Minsk memorandum and what are the arrangements in gas, and that was a complete different interpretation. My question is twofold. From one hand, what was the arrangement in with the Kiev, if that's possible? And the other, is there negotiating with Kiev is possible if those results will be interpreted by Kiev and they will act according to their own will? Are they a trustworthy partner that can not only negotiate but implement the results of the negotiations? Well, as for the answer to the latter part of the question is in process of forming, because of course we have had arrangements in Minsk which were started in the implementation. Before that, I mentioned the joint statement from April by Russia, Ukraine, United States and European Union that would be prepare the grounds for constitutional reform, but that was not the case since Kiev did not take any actions in that direction. But before signing the agreement with European Union in June, President Poroshenko has conducted two or three round tables in regions, but that was not representatives. That was not a representative community, since there were not all regions and all people. So the first matter of implementation of those arrangements between Kiev and the militia are the Minsk arrangements. As President Putin said, in Milan there have been problems from both sides, since it's not easy to separate the opponents. In accordance with the requests of Ukrainian representatives, we sent, OSCE observers, we sent our specialists to settle the line of separations that would be acceptable for both sides, and we're also talking about the withdrawal of heavy weaponry of different caliber and specific distance. That was all agreed on, but then there were certain problems, and we count on that in the nearest future all problems will be settled, and then will talk about implementing those arrangements. It's important to control those arrangements so they are not violated. And there, as provided for by Minsk Protocol, everyone is in favor to convey the role of observer to the OSCE, which for that aim has asked for additional equipment, protected vehicles, and UAVs. We are ready to help them in this endeavor. In Milan, this matter was discussed thoroughly. We mentioned that we are ready to take our part in equipping that mission, that we are ready to provide drones and teams to operate those drones. And there were similar statements from our French and Italian colleagues. And according to the results of negotiations in Milan, the military representatives of those countries who made those suggestions will convey in Vienna, and together with OSCE Secretariat, with the president of the OSCE, agree on the principles of work of those UAVs. Of course, that is needed to be done in consultation and in accordance with the viewpoints of the representatives of Donetsk and Luhansk, since we should be sure about the status of a line of separation between Ukrainian military and the militia. And the principles of the work of the UAV should be discussed with the representatives of the fighting parties. We, as we have proposed our own UAVs, we are ready to discuss the technical matters. I have read the statements from Kiev on the result of the Milan arrangements, that there are arrangements on exercising control in all the Russian-Ukrainian border, and more specifically it was said that in the nearest future all the border control will be reset to Ukrainian customs officers. That's not true, because so that all those posts were conveyed under the control of Ukrainian customs officers, that needs the agreement from the militia who control those posts. And then the other matter is the status of quo, is about the status quo. Nobody talked about changing the status quo in Milan. Everyone said about securing this line of separation, and that's it. Moreover, President Putin said that in the part of Russian side of Russian-Ukrainian border, we have all responsibility for security in that region. As for the other side of the border, it's controlled by the militia fighters. That's the territory we are talking about. And we should talk about, and you should talk to them, not to us. And I agree that the interpretation of those arrangements is not very scrupulous. Of course, it doesn't help. It creates in Ukrainian society maybe a little hyped in view of near elections. They are led to believe that there are certain changes in our position, and that showed in the comments on the gas problem. I have heard that allegedly we have agreed on 375 in winter and 325 in summer. I don't know where those figures come from. That was not the matter of summer or winter. We're talking about the nearest 5 months. No, of course, that's winter time, but in legal terms, no one mentioned winter price, because that would mean that there was different, that was different from summer price. But right until the end of March, we have agreed upon the price. We agree that Ukraine has the right to buy as much gas as it needs, and Gazprom is ready to take a flexible stance on that matter. The only matter that we did not agree on, Ukraine needs 1.5 or 2 months. It lacks, as President Putin has said, that they lack money from the naphtha gas of Ukraine. And we were talking about 1.5 billion euros. And our Western partners have tried to talk us into taking that on ourselves. You have heard what our president said, but I believe that Eurocommission and Germany and France, of course, can lend $1.5 billion for 1.5 months if they know that that money will come back. But you see, they didn't want to do even that. But if they did that in Milan, we would have signed the document by now. But so we didn't have the agreement on gas for that reason. And I was very surprised that the Minister of Energy of Ukraine, when he answered the question on the state of negotiations on gas, despite what Andrei Kolesnikov wrote, I mentioned about his mentioning his comment in Milan, he said that Ukraine is moving towards victory in the matter of gas. If we believe, if we consider that in military terms, only God can judge them. But we believe that's that we are working towards a compromise.
Well, actually, the Ukrainian policy is developing according to some specific terms recently. The floor is yours, please. Sergei Viktorovich, my name is Vladimir Davidov, and I'm here to present the Russian University of People's Friendship. I'd like actually to ask you a question related to the region that is to the north from what we've discussed. Speaking about the Arctic projects, does the government of the Russian Federation have any alternative options to promote our national interests? Thank you. Well, you know, no area of international cooperation is immune to unilateral actions on behalf of actors and is not immune to the influence of events that are taking place beyond the region. Nevertheless, cooperation in the Arctic is resilient enough. From time to time, we hear, and we started hearing that long before the Ukrainian events, well, we've heard that NATO wants to increase its profile in the region to strengthen its position. They reiterate that again and again. And the NATO doctrines and their analysis from time to time contain the issue of increasing the role of the military factor in the Arctic. It is going to happen due to increasing strife for resources in the region. We believe that in the Arctic there are no issues that would require NATO's participation. Moreover, there are no problems that could require military solution. The Arctic is a territory of the dialogue. It is the motto that we use at fora that are regularly carried out in the Russian Federation. And that is how we want to build our work within the Arctic Forum. And I hope that all the Arctic countries realize that we are mutually interdependent, that we are facing common challenges in environment, in the necessity to ensure security of ocean routes, the Northern Sea route, and the Northwestern route, which is our, in our Western Hemisphere. And of course, all of the countries I've mentioned are interested in cooperating and in protecting our applications to the commission that defines the borders of the Arctic shelf. This is where we successfully cooperate with some of our Arctic neighbors. And speaking about the Arctic Council, we've gained some positive experience so far. We've already reached a first intergovernmental legally binding agreement in environment. At the moment, we are developing an agreement on preventing the oil pollution of the maritime environment in the Arctic. We are also getting ready an agreement on the international scientific cooperation in the Arctic. This is the issue that a whole number of works in the Arctic Council has been devoted to. And the Arctic Economic Council started its operation in the fall. And actually, I do not see any persuasive signs of Arctic Council members changing their position. We are going to stick to our position, and we are going to promote our interests based on the agreements that have been reached so far. We want to provide for the rights and promotion of interests of indigenous minorities of the North. They participate in every session of the Arctic Council. And also, we are definitely going to develop the infrastructure in the Arctic region of the Russian Federation. It is relevant both to ecology and to provision of maritime security and the navigation security, as well as to the security of our state in this very important area. Let us now give the floor to young participants of our meeting. Could you please give the mic to the next speaker?
Здравствуйте, Андрей Снягин, Молодая гвардия. Сергей Викторович, скажите, пожалуйста.
My name is Andrei Snyagin, Молодая гвардия. Sergei Viktorovich, speaking about our relations with India. They have been progressively developing, and we supply a number of weapons to India. Do you think India could use our weapons in counteracting ISIS? Thank you. You know, India, like any other country, can use weapons, including Russia-supplied weapons and weapons supplied from many other countries, to any purpose that does not violate the international law. I suppose it is an evident thing, and the only reservation that we always include in our contracts is that the end user should not change. If the end user is Indian Army, that it is Indian Army that is supposed to use our weapons. If a military contact occurs in India, then of course India has a right to use those weapons like American Army or any other army in the world. If India is engaged in international peacekeeping operations, then of course India has to decide for itself. India has a right to use these weapons in any way that is not in violation of the international law and the principles in weapons and the principles in trade in weapons. Well, let me expand the question a little bit. You know, there is an issue of international coalition countering the ISIS. At the moment, the United States are building their coalition, and those countries willing to take part in it, like Canada or Australia, are already in it. But there are more countries willing to take part, including Russia and India. China is also interested in engaging in that cooperation. At least China is very concerned with what is going on. And actually, all the members of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization are concerned with the aggravation of the Islamic factor. on behalf of our country and our closest partners, big regional and global powers, do you think they are willing to create a big coalition that, under its own guidance, not under the guidance of the United States, could take independent military effort or any other diplomatic efforts, for example? Well, speaking about the diplomatic, political, and rights protection efforts, of course. And you know, the structure of the kind already exists. First, the CSTO, for example, at the moment, conducts relevant operations at the borders of Afghanistan. They are directly involved in forestalling the drug trafficking routes. They also do a lot to freeze financing of terrorism. And another organization that is involved in the process is Shanghai Cooperation Organization. It is also focused on forestalling threats emanating from Afghanistan. The organization is unique because Afghanistan has an observer status in the SCO, and all Afghanistan's members, with no exception, participate in the work of SCO in this or that way. And at the moment, some of them are going to get a status of a fully-fledged member instead of the observer status. They are going to make a transition from the observer status to a status of a full-fledged member. At the most recent SCO summit, those issues were discussed. And at the moment, members are discussing those issues on the eve of the next SCO summit that is going to take place in Russia. And the applications from India and Pakistan will be considered. They have already applied for member status in SCO. So the organization is taking a whole series of measures aimed at stabilizing the situation in Afghanistan and around it. They also do a lot to strengthen the state in Afghanistan and to enhance the regional cooperation around the issue. And I believe that we could do the same in other areas, including combating the terrorist threat that is emanating from Iraq, Syria, and other countries of the region. We could also form ad hoc coalitions. You know, when the conflict in Yemen was settled, a terrorist threat emanating from the country was still very strong, and the threat still exists in Yemen. You know, a trend to separatism and to collapse of the country is still prominent. But in order to agree on the principles of the conflict resolution, an ad hoc coalition was formed. That was called a Group of Ten. It included the United States, Russia, and a number of neighboring countries. The EU also take part in the group. The Ten shaped a certain framework for conflict settlement and addressed the UN Security Council. This was just an ad hoc coalition, but still they addressed the Security Council. The Council considered the address, and then, upon the agreement of Yemen authorities, they adopted a settlement plan. The plan for conflict resolution was implemented, but then the president, who left the power according to his own will, still has some political mechanisms to influence the situation. What I'm talking about is the political aspect. It is very important. The thing is that an ad hoc coalition addressed the Security Council, and the proposed plan was adopted. The SCO and the CSTO are both prominent organizations. They have memorandum of cooperation with the United Nations. They are both legitimate organizations that can act according to their free will based on the UN Charter. You know, there's Chapter 8 in the UN Charter that promotes regional organizations to get engaged in resolving conflicts in the relevant regions. But, you know, if some countries launch an initiative of taking military actions, of going beyond just diplomatic and political means, they definitely have to address the Security Council and ask it for permission. I'm absolutely convinced that this principle should be applied to efforts taken to counteract ISIS. You know, it is called ISIS now. However, at the moment, the coalition that has been built by the United States is not willing to address the Security Council, and it only proves our assessment that this coalition has been created in violation of the UN Charter, because they can only use force if there is a certain permission of the United Nations or the permission of the country where you want to bomb terrorists. Thank you. We've been working for 2 hours already. One last question, please. I'd like to give the floor to you.
There's someone raising a hand. Mr. Lavrov, good day. Thank you for the wonderful job you are doing for the victories and triumphs for our country. Alexander Murovsky, I am head of the Federal Commission of United Russia Party proponents. We can see that Russia is gradually coming back to Cuba, and Cuba used to be a geopolitical hub of tension. What are the current plans of the Russian Federation in terms of Cuba? And given the influence of the United States, is it an irritant in talks with the United States? Cuba has been our long-standing partner. It's a legendary country. It's a symbol of freedom in Latin America. And even all those governments in Latin America that are West-oriented, without any exception, are in favor of Cuba. Thus, they show them the understanding that freedom is something greater than just taking the recipes of the United States for granted, because the United States says that everybody who's in favor of democracy and freedom should follow them, which is not true. We, for a certain period of time, had a long pause in our relations when the Soviet Union collapsed. It was not specifically about Cuba, but with other states in Latin America, Africa, and Asia. Not only because back then the government thought that we did not need very many partners in the Third World. And everybody thought that close ties with the West would solve all our problems. But anyway, we didn't have enough means. We had a lot of problems, and we never had an extra hand or amount of money. A number of embassies, like in African countries, were closed. But over the last decade, we have turned back to our old friends, and there are some moral factors to it. Like, people keep turning to us and looking up at us, and for us it's of importance to feel that we're their loyal allies and reciprocate this warm feeling. And the second factor is not merely of morality, it's a pragmatic factor. Some people may share values with us. These are ready to defend these values at the international arena, which manifested itself in very many specific issues, like the vote on Crimea, when the majority of Latin American countries did not support the Western stance, but spoke in favor of our position. And when we voted the resolution on Abkhazia and South Ossetia, that was also the case. In recent years, Cuba has become a valuable partner, and contacts at all levels have stepped up. It's not only talk. We have signed documents, intergovernmental and intercorporate agreements. Russian corporates, together with their Cuban peers, engage in a number of long-term projects. President Putin visited Cuba this year. Previously, I paid a visit there, and I can see good promise in our cooperation with Cuba. Never in our contacts with the United States they touched upon Cuba. It's done by us. We are the initiators. We do that regularly. We try, although so far in vain, to persuade them that the unilateral trade embargo against Cuba is useless. And the United States inflicts damage on itself, because Europe keeps putting up money in Cuba, Canada as well, the Russian Federation as well, and proving, well, there is no anti-American sentiment in Cuba. They have their own pride, naturally. They are ready to tackle issues with the Americans included, based on the equal footing. These are very worthy people, lovers of freedom. And in terms of healthcare, they do a lot for their Latin American partners. And like leaders of Brazil and Argentina and Venezuela have spoken about it with enthusiasm, with adoration. The Cuban doctors are of high quality. It's a trademark. And John Kerry had to admit that when he said that Cuba would send tens or thousands of specialists and professionals to fight Ebola fever in Guinea and North Africa and Liberia. Cuba has good prospects, and our cooperation bears promise as well. Thank you so much. 4 years ago, Sergei Lavrov and I inaugurated the Center of the Russian World in Havana. And in Cuba, they read Pushkin, the verses of Pushkin. And this is also a country that for more than 50 years has been under severe and hard sanctions and shows no signs of giving in or bending under the burden of the sanctions. They demonstrate their dignity. I believe that all of us should thank Minister Lavrov for today's lecture that made us much more competent in foreign affairs than 2 hours back, and we have learned a lot. And Minister Lavrov gave us an overview of the diplomatic activities of the recent days. So let us thank him for the huge work done by him, for his efforts to defend our national interests consistently, with commitment and in a smart way, trying to maximize and consolidate our economic and political positions and minimize damage that may be inflicted by not too friendly countries against us. He has huge responsibility, and his efforts make us count that our voice will be heard. There will be remain a great power, a UN Security Council permanent member, and the first level, first tier state Thank you so much. I wish you every success.